In this video, I'm going to show you 9 credit score myths that may be holding you back from buying a house. And look, credit scores are complex and sometimes really overwhelming. And if you overcome these myths, it's going to be easier for you to purchase a home and also do it with the most savings possible. So here's why this matters, is you want an easier loan approval. Nobody wants to go through the home buying process and it to be really complex and really difficult because of where your credit score is at. Also, you'll get lower rates and lower costs, lower closing costs when you have a higher credit score. So myth number one is that shopping for a mortgage hurts your credit score. I hear this over and over again. Somebody gets a pre-approval and then they say, I don't want to get another pre-approval because I'm afraid it will hurt my credit score. Okay, so let's back up for a second and understand the difference between these two different types of credit pulls. All right, so you need a credit pull to get a mortgage approval. There is what's called a soft credit pull and a hard credit pull. The way a soft credit pull works is it has lower accuracy, okay? Because it's based on likely what's called a Vantage scoring model. It's not going to show up on your credit report. And it's used for when you're getting like an estimated kind of pre-qualification to see a general idea of what's on your credit score, okay? A hard pull is going to be extremely accurate. It's going to be listed on your report as a credit inquiry, and it's used for a real pre-approval. So you need a hard pull to be able to get a mortgage pre-approval. Now, the problem here is this is where people have the fear of, oh no, it's on my credit report, and is this going to impact my score? So first of all, the CFPB, this is the regulatory body that oversees extensions of credit, in this case, getting a mortgage pre-approval, says you have a 45-day window. They say within a 45-day window, you can have multiple lenders check your credit without any additional impact to your score. Effectively, you have 45 days for unlimited mortgage inquiries. Okay, so if you get one today, you can get 5 more tomorrow, within the next week, within the next 2 weeks, and it will only count on your score as one inquiry, okay? Those other inquiries will be listed, but it won't impact your score over and over again. It'll count as one inquiry. And then if we look at Experian to see how much does an inquiry impact your score, it says less than 5 points, so 0 to 5 points. They say you can expect a hard inquiry to temporarily decrease your credit score by 5 points or less, according to FICO. But if you have good credit, your score may drop less than that, okay? So ultimately, this myth that shopping for a mortgage hurts your credit score, it absolutely does not. You need a hard credit pull to get an actual, realistic, and reliable pre-approval, okay? Myth number two is Vantage or soft pull scores don't matter, right? Just like we talked about these soft pull methods up here. They have lower accuracy, which is why people tend to prefer finding out what their actual credit score is. The soft pull may be off by a few points, maybe up off by 10 points, 20 points. It really depends on your situation. But a lot of people think that they don't want to have a Vantage score or a soft pull score because they think it's not going to be helpful for them. Okay. Now let's run through some quick definitions really quickly. Each company has multiple versions of soft and hard credit pulls, but commonly when we're talking about a Vantage score, this is what's the most common soft pull scoring algorithm. FICO also has soft pull algorithms, but it's the most common hard pull algorithm that's going to be used by mortgage lenders, okay? So when you're working on credit, you only really need to look at the momentum of your score. I don't know why, but for some reason, people think when they're working on their credit, they need to know exactly what their score is. And we don't really need to know exactly what it is. It doesn't really matter if we're 10 points off, because we can get our exact score at a place like myfico.com if you want. That's the only place that you'd be able to pull your own score that's going to be exactly what a mortgage lender is going to pull. And it's more expensive if you go through a company like that. So you absolutely can, but what we really want to know is when we're looking at our score and when we're working on our credit report or improving our credit score is how do our actions impact our score? We want to get feedback to see, are we on the right track? Are we not on the right track? Or are things stable? Or is our credit score not moving? So momentum gives us the feedback that we're on the right track. Not to mention, when we look at something like a Vantage score, this has no impact to your credit score, and it's a lot cheaper to look at than something like a FICO score. Now, an exact score is really only helpful if we're on the edge of qualifying for a loan program. For instance, conventional loans have a minimum of a 620 score. So maybe we're around the 619-ish range, and we want to get that one extra point and make sure that we have it so that we can qualify for something like a conventional loan. In that instance, absolutely, maybe you want to look at your exact score, but looking at an exact score costs more money, and there's really not a big need to look at that. So here's where to get one. A soft credit pull is on sites like things like Credit Karma or all those other sites where you can get your credit report for free. Another one is your credit card dashboard. If you have a credit card, likely they show you your current score with a soft pull method. And then another one is ScoreMaster. So this video is sponsored by ScoreMaster, and you can get a 7-day trial at scoremaster.com/Kyle. And this is what I personally use. So when you first open your ScoreMaster dashboard, it's going to show you three tools. You have your score tracker. So this is going to show you that, again, that soft pull. So you can track the momentum of your score and how that changes over time, which is exactly what we want to see when we're actually doing our own work on adding points to our credit score. Also, Score Builder and Score Boost. So Score Builder shows us the actions that we can take. So inside a Score Builder, it's going to walk us through a long-term plan to get us on the right track with our score. And then Score Boost, what this can do is show us the payments that we can make on our current accounts and how many points can be added to our credit score. So we can actually take a look in here at where current score might be at, and then also take a look at our different accounts and how much we could pay and how it would impact our credit score. So you can see an additional 25 points here by paying $3,300 in our test account here. And it shows you exactly which accounts and then the payment amount to get an additional 6 points pay by a specific date. So again, that 7-day trial is at scoremaster.com/Kyle. Now, myth number three is that credit work is hard. Now, most people think there's like some sort of trick or hack to get it right. And the truth is, credit is too complex to do on your own efficiently. You absolutely can do it on your own if you'd like to. I've tried to do it on my own and it's extremely complex. You're trying to do all this research to figure out what to do. And ultimately, it's best to either have software or human guidance through the process. Because again, you can absolutely do the work on your own, but if you want to get to the spot where you want to get quicker, it's easier to have some guidance. So there's two primary ways to get guidance, is either through working with a credit coach or through ScoreMaster or another credit simulation software. Myth number four is that the only way to fix my credit is through expensive coaching. Okay, so I want to walk you through a couple different credit improvement tools or strategies that people use. One that I see a lot on like social media, Instagram and other things, is like credit hacking, where they're like, pay this company money and they're going to hack your credit report and remove whatever or add whatever accounts. These are scams, okay? Please don't fall for these things. There are a lot of companies out there that will say they can improve your credit score and basically they're going to take money from you and not do anything. Any company that says we will do the work for you is likely going to be a scam, okay? That's not how credit, even credit coaching works. You still have to put in work on your own credit score. Also, low touch coaching. So there are a lot of sites or a lot of companies that will offer low touch coaching. So it's going to be credit counseling or credit coaching for a lower cost. And you may have an advisor with that, but often some of what can end up happening is they might just send out like blanket mailers to file disputes, or they give you some general guidance that doesn't offer really great results. Another option is high touch coaching. And this is great for complex credit issues, or if you really need to get a really big increase in your credit score in a short amount of time, but these can be pretty expensive. Another one is research-based do-it-yourself options. This can be time consuming and not always the most efficient. So this is if you're combing through different articles and trying to understand how to do it yourself. It's absolutely a strategy, but it can take a lot of time. And again, it may not be the best path forward in the quickest amount of time. Another one is software-based DIY tools. And this is great for removing errors and finding your best score. So, you know, two examples or a couple examples here. You're going to get a soft pull from your credit card info. They might have some help there. You can use ScoreMaster, like I mentioned in this video. Another one too is your loan officer may have access to credit simulation software as well that can help you through that as well. Another strategy that a lot of people need is time on their side to get high scores. And this is often for people who don't really have a lot of credit work that they needed in the first place. Maybe they're at a 700 score and they want to get to an 800 or a 740 or whatever. And often for those people, it's just going to take time on your account for your score to increase over time. Myth number five is that you need a good score to buy a house. These are the minimum credit scores needed for the most common types of loans. For a conventional loan, you need a 620 credit score. For an FHA loan, you need a 500 credit score. For USDA, you need a 500 credit score. And for VA, you need 500 credit score. So you don't need a super high credit score to qualify for a mortgage. Now, there are a lot of lenders who won't let you do a loan with these credit scores, and I'll explain that here in a second. Okay. So what I would suggest is if you're in a spot where your credit is on the lower side, use a mortgage as a bridge. So what you can do is still purchase a home. And after you purchase a home, your credit score, as you pay down your mortgage, is going to increase over time. And then what I would suggest is in that period of time is as you're working on your credit is maybe you got an FHA loan because you had a lower credit score and you buy the house and then you need to start working on your credit so that you can refinance into something like a conventional loan, which is going to have better interest and mortgage insurance savings long-term for you. Now, ultimately, this is a personal choice. What I would do is if I was in a situation where I had a lower credit score is I would first ask what brought me to the place of having the low credit score. If there's some habits in your life or there's some budgeting problems or maybe there's some other financial circumstances that is going to keep you having a lower credit score, then maybe it's not the best time to purchase a house. What I would suggest is only look at purchasing a house if you have a credit that's middle to on the lower end, is if you know that you're going to be able to continue working on improving your credit score in the future. We want to correct those habits before we purchase a house. Okay, so it's a personal choice that is up to you. Now, there's this thing called lender overlays, where a lot of lenders will actually come in and say, actually, we won't do a conventional loan unless you have a 640 score, or a FHA loan unless you have a 640 score. So those are called overlays. And what you can do is talk to multiple different lenders to see what other options you may have. But these are the bare minimums here. And my team works with lenders that go all the way down to these minimums. So if you're running into overlays with other lenders, reach out to my team. We can schedule a free home loan consult. The link is in the description. And we can connect you with lenders who go all the way down and don't have these overlays if you're running into that problem. Myth six is if you have bad credit, you shouldn't buy a house. This is always a fun one. Anytime I make a video about credit, there usually ends up being somebody who says, if someone has a bad credit score, they're a bad person and shouldn't be able to buy anything ever again in the future. And that's a very interesting perspective on life that I don't agree with. Ultimately, credit scores are a made-up system that only show how you pay back debt, right? Please don't forget that credit scores are a game made by three companies that have a monopoly on the credit reporting system. It's all made up, okay? This isn't an indication of how good you are as a person or really a true indication of how well you are handling finances. They don't consider the fact that you may pay your rent on time for the past 10 years, that you paid all your other bills on time, or your budgeting habits. There really is no moral quality to a credit score. It's only a determination of risk used by other people who extend credit. If you get a new credit card or a new auto loan or a new mortgage, plenty of good people have bad credit scores because of things like medical debt. You may get into a car crash or develop an illness. I worked with a client once who got into a car crash, had to be care flighted, had a $100,000 medical bill from the helicopter flight. And he, of course, could not pay that because he was a disabled veteran and had nowhere near enough money to be able to pay $100,000 in medical debt. That just sat on his credit report, and he had a low 500 credit score, and we were able to get him into a home with a VA loan, okay? So it's like that. He's not a bad person because he happened to get in an accident and couldn't pay for a helicopter flight. That doesn't mean he doesn't deserve quality shelter, okay? Also, people can be in abusive relationships or have negligent partners, and that can impact their credit score based on maybe somebody who was in control of finances and wasn't paying things on time, or other issues that prevent somebody from working. There's plenty of other life circumstances that can cause a lower credit score to otherwise responsible and good people. So people with good and bad credit still should be able to seek quality shelter that allows them to build equity without their rent increasing year after year, okay? Myth seven is paying off collections will help my score. Paying off collections can actually hurt your score by updating the date of last activity on your credit report. I know this sounds counterintuitive where you think, well, pay my collections off, then my credit score will finally go up. Unfortunately, that's not the way that it works. A pay for deletion is the best solution for this, where you actually negotiate with the collection agency to say, hey, if I pay this, can it be deleted from my credit report? That doesn't always work. Another option is allowing time to just lessen the impact of the collection and focusing on other areas of your credit report to work on. Myth 8, similar, is that closing a credit card is good. So closing a credit card actually is going to lower the average age of accounts on your credit report and will actually lower your score. You would think, oh man, if I don't use credit, then it's going to be better for my score. And that's not the case. Keep your credit cards open. If you need to keep it active, just go buy a pack of gum at a gas station and then pay it off. Okay, you're not going to pay any interest on it. That's going to make sure your credit card stays open and has that, this is the average age of accounts on your credit report. And then myth 9 is that I can just pay someone to remove stuff I don't want on my credit report. And unfortunately, I see this a lot where people think I can just go hire somebody to take care of the problems on here. No person or service can remove accurate information from your credit report. Okay. So unfortunately, if you have a late payment, let's say you had an auto loan and you didn't pay it when the due date came up, there is no way to remove that. If that's what actually happened, there's no way for that to go away. You can't pay a service, you can't pay a software, you can't pay a person to remove accurate information. What you can do is remove inaccurate information, and it's done through what's called a dispute. So you can dispute inaccurate information to get it removed. What this does is it opens up a short investigation, is what it's called, on your credit report, where the creditor then can come back with proof about if that debt or whatever you're arguing on your credit report is accurate or not. And so what you can do is actually use a tool like ScoreMaster to make it easier to file actions on your credit report. And the ScoreMaster software makes it easy to help file some of these actions for you. So you can do things like fixing credit reporting errors, getting goodwill corrections, paying off or negotiating small debts, or remove identity theft. And so what it will do is walk you through the different accounts that are impacting your credit score. You can then go to take actions on those different accounts. And in here, you can learn more about how this works. But for instance, maybe there was an error that I recognize on a Citibank account. This is not my account. This is a test account here. But maybe there's an error here and I can click fix error and select a reason why and add more details into why this is an error on the report. So ScoreMaster can take care of those actions for me. So if you'd like more guidance with a software-based approach to add more points to your score, you can get a 7-day trial for ScoreMaster at scoremaster.com/Kyle.